Good morning. Welcome to St. Michael the Archangel Catholic Church. If you have not already done so, we ask you to take this opportunity to silence any cell phone you have with you. There will be a second collection today for the Peter's Pence collection, and we ask that you place your envelopes in with the main collection. Today we are celebrating the 13th Sunday in Ordinary Time, and our celebrant is Father Mike Guarino. And we ask you to stand and join in singing our opening song, Gather Your People, found on your worship aid.
For the parishioners of St. Michael's, both living and deceased. And let us begin as we begin all our prayer, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
To prepare ourselves to worthily celebrate these sacred mysteries, let us call to mind our sins. You were sent to heal the contrite, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You plead for us at the right hand of the Father, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you.
God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. God did not make death, nor does he rejoice in the destruction of the living, for he fashioned all things that they might have being, and the creatures of the world are wholesome, and there is not a destructive drug among them, nor any domain of the netherworld on earth, for justice is undying. For God formed man to be imperishable. The image of his own nature he made him. But by the envy of the devil, death entered the world, and they who belong to his company experience it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will praise you, Lord, for you have rescued me. I will praise you, Lord, for you have rescued me. I will extol you, O Lord, for you drew me near and did not let my enemies rejoice over me. O Lord, you brought me up from the netherworld. You preserved me from among those going down into the pit. I will praise you, Lord, for you have rescued me. Sing praise to the Lord, you his faithful ones, and give thanks to his holy name. For his anger lasts but a moment, a lifetime his goodwill. At nightfall, weeping enters in, but with the dawn rejoicing. I will praise you, Lord, for you have rescued me. Hear, O Lord, and have pity on me. O Lord, be my helper. You changed my mourning into dancing. O Lord, my God, forever will I give you thanks. I will praise you, Lord, for you have rescued me.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, as you excel in every respect, in faith, discourse, knowledge, all earnestness, and in the love we have for you, may you excel in this gracious act also. For you know the gracious act of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, for your sake he became poor, so that by his poverty you might become rich. Not that others should have relief while you are burdened, but that as a matter of equality, your abundance at the present time should supply their needs, so that their abundance may also supply your needs, that there may be equality. as it is written, whoever had much did not have more, and whoever had little did not have less. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Christ destroyed death and brought life through light through the gospel.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a large crowd gathered around him, and he stayed close to the sea. One of the synagogue officials named Jairus came forward. Seeing him, he fell at his feet and pleaded earnestly with him, saying, "My daughter is at the point of death. Please, come lay your hands on her, that she may get well and live." He went off with him, and a large crowd followed him and pressed upon him. There was a woman afflicted with a hemorrhage for 12 years. She had suffered greatly at the hands of many doctors, and she had spent all that she had, yet she was not helped, but only grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak. She said, "If I but touch his clothes, I shall be cured." Immediately, her flow of blood dried up. She felt in her body that she was healed of her affliction. Jesus, aware at once that power had gone out from him, turned around in the crowd and said, or asked, "Who has touched my clothes?" But his disciples said to Jesus, "You see how the crowd is pressing upon you, and yet you ask, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. The woman, realizing what had happened to her, approached in fear and trembling. She fell down before Jesus and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has saved you. Go in peace and be cured of your affliction." While he was still speaking, people from the synagogue official's house arrived and said, "Your daughter has died. Why trouble the teacher any longer?" Disregarding the message that was reported, Jesus said to the synagogue official, "Do not be afraid, just have faith." He did not allow anyone to accompany him inside except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they arrived at the house of the synagogue official, he caught sight of a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. So he went in and said to them, "Why this commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but asleep." And they ridiculed him. Then he put them all out. He took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and entered the room where the child was. He took the child by hand and said to her, "Talitha kum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." The girl, a child of 12, arose immediately and walked around. At that, they were utterly astounded. He gave strict orders that no one should know this and said that she should be given something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord. There was a business executive who had become depressed. His work was not going well, and every day he would take his problems home with him. He would eat his dinner every evening in complete silence, just kind of shutting out his wife and 5-year-old daughter. And then after dinner, he would go to the den and he would read the newspaper, holding the newspaper up as kind of a wall to keep them away. This went on for several evenings. Then one evening, his little daughter followed him into the den, and she took her little hand and pulled down the newspaper. And then she jumped up on his laps, put her arms around his neck, and hugged him strongly. And quite abruptly, he said, "Honey, you're hugging me to death." And the little girl replied, "No, Dad, I'm hugging you to life." To me, that's very interesting, because I think that's what Jesus did. He took people where they were and hugged them to life. You know, that's exactly what's going on in the gospel that we just read. Jesus is taking people and who are really hurting, people who are, in a sense, very lowly, and he's lovingly hugging them to life. This is kind of a fascinating scripture passage in Mark, because what we have is two stories, or we could say two healings within one. And the people who were involved could not be any more different. On the one hand, you had the family of Jairus, which was really the upper crust of society. Jairus was the chief official in the synagogue. He was a man of substance, of power, of wealth. He was religiously important. In fact, Jairus was the man who made all the decisions in the synagogue. He decided who would preach. He decided what readings would be read. He decided what hymns would be sung. But this day, Jairus was troubled. His 12-year-old daughter was dying. And then on the other hand, we have this hemorrhaging woman in the crowd. She was an outcast, a social outcast. She was considered unclean under the judgment of God. In fact, she wasn't even allowed to step foot in the synagogue. And what Jesus does in this, as I say, absolutely amazing passage, what he does is he takes these two totally different people and he hugs them to life. And he does that because of the love that he has in his heart, the love that he has shown all the time. And you know something? And I mean this and believe this sincerely. He has given each and every one of us here the power to hug people to life. And why he has done that and how he has done that is because of the greatest gift that he has given us. Every single one of us here has a gift, the same gift, and that is we have the power to love. We know what it means to love. We know what it means to be love. We know that love can heal, it can reconcile, it can redeem. I could ask you, and I bet you could tell me, is there a time in your life that you have felt healed by love? Is there a time in your life you have felt reconciled by love or even redeemed by love? You ever gone to the sacrament of confession? If that's not a time that Jesus hugs us, I don't know when there is. A time that he heals and reconciles and redeems us. But he does that at every sacrament today as we receive communion, the Eucharist, the body and blood of Christ, his very presence. He who hugged the hemorrhaging woman and healed the daughter of Jairus, we're receiving him today, the same person. At that moment when you receive him, ask him if you need it to heal you, to hug you to life. If you need that today, you have the opportunity. If you need to be reconciled, reconciled to love, maybe reconciled with someone, you have that opportunity today, because all of us are receiving the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Body, blood, soul, divinity, as alive today as he was ever alive when he touched the woman, or when the woman touched him and he healed Jairus' daughter, it's the same person. We believe that as Catholics. We believe that deeply. That's why we're here. We will experience today the same hug of love that, as I say, the woman or Jairus' daughter received. But there's always kind of a little hook, always, in dealing with Jesus and receiving anything from Jesus, whether it's love, presence, whatever. The hook is, he always says to us, always, go and do likewise.
Please join with me in the profession of faith.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. God never intended us to die. He created us for life, but we choose death.
Christ, our Redeemer, restores us to life, and we come to our Father praying through him.
That all ministers of the church may continue to proclaim the good news of the risen Christ. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all nations may care for the needs of the most vulnerable. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who mourn the death of a loved one may be consoled by faith in the gentle mercy of our Lord. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may never be afraid of dying. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our dear departed may be raised up to eternal joy in heaven, especially Leo Sina, who died recently. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For St. Michael's parishioners, whom we are remembering in a special way in this Eucharist. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the intentions of the parish prayer line, the intentions in the parish prayer boxes, and our own special intentions. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. All-powerful God, our lives rest in your hand. Trusting in your provident care, we bring our petitions before you through Christ our Lord. Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
O God, who graciously accomplished the effects of your mysteries, Grant, we pray, that the deeds by which we serve you may be worthy of these sacred gifts through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with
lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. Rightly gives you praise, for through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. From the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look upon the Eucharistic offerings of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with Saint Michael, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, Frank, our Bishop, the Order of Bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family you have summoned here before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we have the courage to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our day, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Safely offer each other a sign of God's peace.
Take away the sins of the world.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Happy are we called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
From all your fear, You will hear my voice. I claim you as my choice. Be still and know I am here. I am hope for all who are hopeless. I am eyes for all who long to see. In the shadows of the night, I will be your light. Come and rest in me. Do not be afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow me. I will bring you home. I love you. You are mine. I am the word that leads all to freedom. I am the peace the world cannot give. I will call your name, embracing all your pain. Stand up now, walk and live. Afraid, I am with you. I have called you each by name. Come and follow me. I will bring you home. I love you and you.
The announcements for this week. Adoration will continue to be held on Tuesdays from 9:30 a.m. until 3 p.m. Due to the construction and noise in the church, we will meet in the conference room in the parish office. Look for the sign next to the red door on the side of the parish office. Zoom meetings will take a break until after the 4th of July holiday. They will resume again on Tuesday, July 13th at 7 p.m. Watch for details in the bulletin and the flock note with the link to join. Please remember to take your worship aids with you after Mass. Thank you, and let us pray. May this divine sacrifice we have offered and received fill us with life, O Lord, so that bound to you in lasting charity, we may bear fruit that lasts forever through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord and one another. I haven't celebrated the 10 o'clock Mass with you for a while, and I have a joke that I love, but I don't know if I told it to you, and you gotta tell me, because I don't wanna go through it. Did I tell you about the 30-year-old women that wanted to go to a restaurant, yes or no?
No,
good. There was a group of 30-year-old women, and they had been friends for years, and they wanted to go to a restaurant, and they were trying to decide which one. So they said, oh, well, let's go to the Ocean View, because the waiters there are young and handsome. That's fine. 20 years later, at 50, once again, they're trying to decide, where will we go to dinner? So they said, well, let's go to the Ocean View. It has a great menu and a nice wine list. Fast forward, now they're in their 60s. Where are we going to go to dinner? They said, let's go to the Ocean View. It has a great view of the ocean. So now they're in their 70s, and they're going, trying to decide, where should we go to dinner? They said, let's go to the Ocean View. It's handicap accessible. It has an elevator. Now they're in their 80s. And once again, they're trying to decide, where should we go to dinner? And they said, let's go to the Ocean View. We've never been there before.
Give them hearts for love alone.
done. Grazie.